Everyone. From today, I'm starting a course called FS101. This course is about the things that I consider important for a Java full stack developer. When I say full stack developer, I'm not talking about a developer who knows everything, that is from front end to back end. I'm mainly talking about creating back end engineers with the knowledge of cloud ecosystem. So I'm Shekhar Gulati. I have been doing software development for the last 15 years. I have also been a speaker at different international conferences, including Java 1, Red Hat Summit, and many others. So, purpose of this course is I want young engineers in the range of with experience range of 1 to 2 years or more. I want to teach them how to do software development the right way. So when I say software development in the right way, I'm mainly talking about how to think about their software, how to think in terms of object-oriented design, how to think about refactoring your code, how to think about writing test cases for the code that they write, how to clean up the code that you write. Also teach you how to go about solving problems. Most of the time that we developers spend is in debugging problems, so this I will try to cover as well. I will try to teach the essential skills that I talked about: object-oriented design, thinking about different kind of databases, like when to choose a relational database, when to go with a NoSQL database, how can you mix and match as well, how to take your application and take it to cloud. So we will cover some aspect of AWS as well. We will talk about CI, we will talk about CD as well, continuous delivery as well. So this is more around a cloud backend engineer course. I will not talk about front-end development, whether you should be using React or Vue or Angular. That's not the intention behind this course. The intention is to teach, make you a good back-end engineer, somebody who is humble and curious to know new things. So the topics, few of them I already mentioned. The topics that we will be covering is object-oriented design. The first week I will be setting up the basic Java foundation, in case few of you are rusty right now. So I will cover simple core Java, so that we will spend close to 1 week. There will be daily homework that you can also do, and there will be weekend assignment as well, so that you can start getting into Java development mode. We will also cover unit testing. We will look into unit testing on the third day. So I want to ensure that people start getting into testing mindset from the beginning. So it's not something that you have to introduce later in the course. I will be introducing them that in the third day. Then I will be talking about refactoring a lot as well. How to clean up the code that you are writing, how to apply different refactoring shortcuts using IntelliJ. So I will be using IntelliJ throughout the course. Then I will talk about how to write clean and maintainable code. So we will cover a few design patterns as well as solid design principles as well. I will also refer a lot of times to the Effective Java item. So I highly recommend a book called Effective Java. So I will be using that as well, few of the items mentioned in that book. Once we know the core Java, once we know how to build libraries, we will move on to something like building the database schema. So we'll look at relation database to start off. We will look at how to create ER diagram, how to think about which all tables you need to have, which all entities in your system needs to have. Along with the relation database, I will also cover Redis and MongoDB, two known relation databases that I usually end up using in my applications. Then we will talk about REST API design. So we will think about how to design the CRUD operations. Along with that, I also want to how to build API which moves beyond CRUD, like create, read, update, delete, how to think about operations which don't go into the standard CRUD mode. So I will cover that as well, how to version your REST API, how to go about securing your REST API endpoints. Mainly we will be using Spring Boot ecosystem for that. So we will be covering Spring Boot and how to build REST APIs using Spring Boot. So it will be mainly around Java ecosystem, Spring Boot ecosystem. in Java 8, we also have a lot of functional, we have now functional primitives in Java like lambdas. So we'll cover about how you can go about thinking in terms of functional paradigm as well. So we'll cover few functional programming concepts as well, so that you can approach that in your code. I talked about RDBMS and NoSQL, I will cover both of them. So we'll talk about cloud as well, mainly AWS. We'll talk about Docker as well, how you can package your application using Docker. And in the end, I also want to talk about if you have an application, how you can break that into microservices, how do microservices can communicate, what should be the communication pattern, synchronous or asynchronous, and other things related to that. So there's a lot of content that we will be covering in this course. Slides for today are on this link. So it is bit.ly/FS101day01. So anybody can access it. It is public. So you should be able to view them. This we are doing virtually, so I will not be able to ask questions to you, to any of you who are listening it. But the whole idea is that any slide which has question mark on it is for you to think about before moving ahead. So you can stop the video, think about the answer. Once you know the answer or probably have thought about the answer, then try to go ahead. The point is you think as you move along. So let's start with the lecture one content. Let's start with today's content. Rather than starting with the Java Spring Boot or going into any technical details, I want to start with something very simple, something that we do daily, but we don't think much on that. like what happens when you type google.com and press enter, what all things are involved in it, how your page gets rendered. So I'm not talking about how browser will render HTML, CSS and JavaScript. I'm thinking about how does the request makes to the Google server, how does the response come back to the Google server. Think about it for a few seconds. I'm waiting. Now let's move ahead. So I thought about this question and I thought, why should I start this course with this question? I think to become a good web backend engineer, so I'm talking about a backend engineer who will be building web backends like REST APIs or any sort of API, even gRPC or GraphQL. I think this stuff is very relevant because the request to your system will be coming through internet or intranet if your service is behind some kind of a firewall or API gateway. So it is important that you know that a lot of things have happened in the last 50 years which make these things happen. So it is important to know that. You will also appreciate the complexity that it all entails, and still it works. I think it's one of the example of how complex system can work. It's a highly distributed system, but it still works very well. And I think one more thing that I want to inculcate in everyone as part of this course is how we can question the obvious things. Sometimes we take a lot of things on face value, but we don't try to question them. So this course will go into that as well. So before we answer the bigger question about how Google is rendered. So if you go to Google, so the question is that if I type google.co.in, how does this page get rendered? How does I see this HTML page? Let's talk about something very fundamental. What is web? I think a lot of time we use this word web, World Wide Web, www, but what does it really mean? Think about it for a few seconds. Do you really know it? Web, as we know, a lot of people try to think web and internet interchangeably, so we use these two words very interchangeably, but web is not internet. Web is an open standard that defines how information can be shared across different machines that are connected over a network. The network could be internet or intranet. So this is the thing that was, this is the problem that scientists were trying to solve in 1980s. So Tim Berners-Lee came up with a proposal for WWW or World Wide Web in 1980, and then it became standardized and now we all are using it. But web is not internet. It's only about the foundations of the web are three things. One is the HTML, which is the markup language, the pages that we see that every browser can render. The second is the uniform resource identifier, that every that it a kind of address that is unique and you are able to easily identify a resource on the web, so that everything is identifiable. Like if you go to google.com, this is also a URI, so, or shekhargulati.com, that is also a URI. And the third part is the HTTP, which is the protocol. Protocol defines the set of rules how you can talk to the other component. So HTTP defines how you can talk to the different resources on the web. So these are the three foundations of the web. Next, move to what is internet. I think we covered briefly about what internet is. So internet is the network part. It's the global network of network. Nobody owns it. So you can think in terms of internet is the infrastructure, and World Wide Web is an application that is running on top of that infrastructure. So to make www or World Wide Web possible, you need internet. So internet is a problem, that internet is the technical solution that makes this thing possible. Internet is the backbone of the web, the technical infrastructure that makes the web possible. At its most basic level, internet is a large network of computers which communicate with it. It's a highly decentralized system. Nobody owns it. And this is what is making everything possible. I will recommend you watch a video, so the link is here. There's a few minutes video, like 3 or 4 minutes video, that you can watch and get an understanding about what internet is from the creator of the internet. It's a nice video that you can watch. Let's move on. So I was just looking at the statistics on internet. How does the world population, how much world population is covered by internet across different regions? As you can see, Asia has been on the rise for the last 10-15 years or 19 years. So we have 50% of the population which is covered under internet. But if you look at that, Africa is something that is picking up right now. I think this is the reason why organizations like Google and Facebook are investing a lot in Africa, because that's the place which is where a lot of new internet users are coming in. But both Asia and Africa has still a lot of possibilities, because the population is large. Asia constitutes 55% of the population, so still it's still a big chunk. If you compare it with the America or Europe, they are relatively covered, so 87%, 89%. So internet is still growing. Lot more application needs to be accessible over internet. Lot more information needs to be accessible over internet. So we are all working on something that is very relevant for a foreseeable future. The last basic term that I want to talk about is a protocol. So protocol defines a set of rules which defines how two entities can talk to each other. So one of the protocols that we normally use is HTTP, Hypertext Transfer Protocol. So the language of HTTP is HTTP methods, like get, post, put, delete, head, connect, option. So these are the normal methods that we use, methods that HTTP supports. When you are building REST APIs, which we will be covering few weeks down the line, we are also building a protocol, but that protocol sits on top of HTTP, and that's an application specific protocol. So we specify how you can talk to my application. That's also one of the protocols that we are building. So we will be also building a protocol, but it will be based on top of HTTP. And it's very common, like protocols sit on top of each other. Now let's go back to the first question, that from where we started. What it means for a browser to server google.com. If you have thought about it, I think in simple terms, it essentially means that we are rendering a file from the server. So there is a file usually called index.html. This is the HTML page that gets rendered when you go to abc.com. Normally you have a file called index.html that gets rendered. So there is a file somewhere sitting on the Google server that we are rendering. So in a sense, that's what it means. But a high level answer to that is, so when you go to your browser, you type google.com here, you talk to something called internet that we just talked about, a global network of network. The information travels across the internet, reaches google.com data center. This is the data center of Google. One of the machines will respond to that answer, and that answer will flow back to the user. But it is very high level. It does not tell, it does not give answers to a lot of questions that you might have. questions like what it means for your machine to be connected to internet. How does browser know which Google server to connect to? So how does browser know that I have to talk to this Google server here? How does browser make call to google.com? So this is your machine view and the browser view. The second view is the internet view. So how does internet work? How does internet finds google.com? How does response from internet is received by your machine? So how does the information from here to go back here? We also need to understand who serves the request. So there are three servers, if you can see here, 1, 2, 3. Which of those served our request? How Google maintains availability? So there are billions of requests being made to Google every day. How Google is managing all of those requests, and how they are able to serve these requests very fast. So then there are a few questions that we need to understand to get a better understanding of the question. So let's look at the part one, which is the left side here, where we talked about the machine and the browser. Let's talk about the first question that we have, what it means for our machine to be connected to internet. In simple, it means that your machine has an IP address. IP address is a random string of numbers, normally in the form of xxx.xxx.xxx.xxx, where this can be between 0 to 255. And the second thing is that you can talk to few other sites which are hosted on internet. So that's what it means. So if I'm on a machine and I ping google.com, I'm able to talk to it. Now look at this diagram. So what happened is that you have your laptop here, you start your laptop, it's talked to something called a Wi-Fi router. This is the Wi-Fi router that we have. This Wi-Fi router talks to your telephone post, and that goes to the Airtel network. In Airtel network, there is something called a DHCP server. This is responsible for giving a public IP address. This public IP address goes to the telephone post, goes to back to your router, and your router now has a public IP address. This is the IP address that your machine has. But usually you will know that we have multiple machines, and we can't give all the machines a public IP address. So they, if you talk about the IP addresses, so it's a 32 bit number. So 2 raised to power 32 is 4 billion. So we can't have more than 4 billion numbers. Now that is the limitation that we have, so we can't have more than that. And right now globally we have something like 7 billion devices, so probably more than that. So we can't use 4 billion IP addresses to serve probably 8 billion devices. So the magic that happens is that your machines get a something called an internal IP address. These IP addresses are in the range of 192.xxx.xxx.xxx, or they are either 10.x. So these two IP ranges are for the internal ranges. So if I go here, probably let me just go in here and I type ifconfig ipgrep 192. So you will see that my machine has an IP address called 192.168.1.5. So this is an internal IP address. And if you have to see your public IP address, you can say what is my IP, and you will find that this is your public IP. So which is very different from the IP address that we just saw, which is 192.168.5. Now the what will happen is that in my society or organization, this is the IP that is shared by all of the people. So one public IP address, but all of us have a different IP address on our local machine. So that's what is happening. And this is the magic that makes it possible for us to have multiple lot many devices as compared to the number of IP addresses that we can have. So if you are on Mac like I am, you can use ifconfig to find that. On Windows you can use ipconfig, on Ubuntu you can use ifconfig. Few terms that you should be aware of: data packet is the information that is being sent from one computer to another, so it gets broken into small packets which travel over the wire. and that data is getting reassembled at the target. IP address is this is what you get when your computer is on the internet. It gives basically a machine a name that you can talk to. Router are the devices that direct or route information around the internet, so they know what they have, which next router they have to talk to, and how they should make the data transfer from one router to another, because they can read the IP address on the packet information, and that's how they can route the information. Another second point is, now that our machine has an IP address, but how does we know which Google server we can talk to? That is made feasible by something called, so before that, I talked about every machine has an IP address, but you don't type for google.com, you don't type its IP address. What you type is google.com. This is a human readable name that you have. So what happened is that there's a service called DNS. DNS is a domain name service which translate the domain name like google.com to IP address. And this is the first thing that happens when you want to talk to any application. The first thing that you have to do is you have to resolve the domain name. And I can show that demo as well. So if I go to my browser and type google.com, probably let's see that. And the first let's just go up. The first request, you can see that there is first thing that is being done is a DNS lookup. So it took somewhere around 6.95 milliseconds. So that's the first thing that it did. If I think refresh it, it should not see that again. Hopefully. You can see now there is no DNS lookup. So the first thing that it does is a DNS lookup, try to resolve the IP address, and then you have the IP address to which you can talk to. There are a couple of popular DNS lookup services. I think you might already be aware of that. One is by Google, which is 8.8.8. One is by Cloudflare, which is 1.1.1. And Cloudflare is more performant as compared to Google's. So you can try that as well. Typically your internet provider also gives you some kind of a DNS resolver as well, that might also be set up in your configuration, network configuration. Let's try to understand how DNS server works. I think that will help to understand how your domain name gets resolved. Now we are considering a worse case right now. DNS normally is cached in your machine by your browser, by your operating system. So normally you never make a network call to fetch the IP address. Like for google.com, it will already be resolved for you. Your browser might already have that for you. But let's consider a worst case where your machine does not have the IP address for a domain. So what happened is that a user type example.com in the web browser, the first thing that it does, it basically goes to something called a DNS resolver. In our case, if we are using Google's or Cloudflare, this is basically 1.1.1 or 8.8.8. So that's the first request we talk to. So we don't know about any of these servers. We only know about the Google or the Cloudflare DNS resolver. So example.com, so the request is made to the example.com. Every website also has a dot at the end. So if I do google.com, what I'm actually making is google.com dot. So that would request I'm making. This is the root domain. Now let's assume DNS resolver does not have it cached. What it will do is it will talk to the root server, the dot behind google.com. So DNS resolver knows the IP addresses or the machines which are the root server. So it has the details of all of them. So it will go to the root server and say that, do you have information about google.com? Let's assume it also does not have it cached. So what it will do is it will talk to the TLD server, which is the top level domain server. So it will say that I don't know about google.com, but I know about .com. So it will go to and these .com, .io, .in, .info, these are all top level domains. So it will go to a TLD server. It will say that, do you know about google.com? It will say that I don't know about google.com, but I know the name server who will be managing the google.com, so, or the example.com in our case. And that's how finally you will end up at authoritative name server, which will know the IP address of the machine, and that will get shared with the DNS resolver. DNS resolver will share it with the example.com, and finally you will have the IP address. There's also another good video that you can watch. Again, there's a link in here. It's a YouTube video again, so you can watch it. That also goes into depth on it. Now that your machine has IP address from the DHCP server, a private IP address given by your router, so a public address was given by the DHCP server of Airtel network to your router. Your router gave also act to the DHCP server and gave you a private IP address. Now your machine has a private IP address. What it does first is that it basically talks to the DNS server and gets the IP address of the Google data center server. So it will basically get information about which Google server to talk to. So what happened here is that one important question here is to understand is that we have an IP address which is private here, but data needs to flow back from the Google data center to the our laptop. So it can't use the private IP address that we have here because it can't talk to the private machine. So what usually happens is that we have a public IP address which is sitting at our router. So Google, so when the request come from your machine to the Wi-Fi address, it basically does some kind of a mapping here. So the mapping maintains that from this IP address, this request is being made. This is the private IP. So all the external requests are made using the public IP, but it does the mapping like this request was made by this private IP, so that it can render return the response back to the current IP address, so that if two people are directly using the same router, they should not see each other's content. So this is taken care by the router layer itself. This is basically called the network address translation. So your private IP to public IP and back transformation. So this is basically called NAT, network address translation. Now the second part of in our picture was the internet. So internet, as we talked about, is the global network. In simple terms, what internet does is basically find the shortest route to the destination. So now it knows that it needs to talk to the google.com server. It has the IP address which is coming from your, because he resolved it using the DNS server. So now it knows how it, so it knows that this is the IP that it talks to. So it basically using its network, it finds the shortest path to it and goes back and find that connect to that Google server IP address. What I will recommend is that there is a 5-minute video that you can watch to go more into detail. But at the end of the day, what it is doing, it is finding the right machine that you can talk to over the network. So it is basically getting the shortest path to that machine. I think the last important point is on the Google side of things. First thing that we have to understand is that we usually don't get the IP address of the server. What we get is the IP address of a load balancer, something that is in front of the server machines. You usually don't make your servers public. You normally keep something like a load balancer in front of your servers, and that is what will be serving the request. So what happened is that, so this dispatcher is nothing more than a load balancer. So your clients talk directly to the load balancer, again over internet. This load balancer knows which all workers your system has, and depending on the algorithm that it want to use, it will basically find the right machine and the data will be transferred back to the client. So load balancer is about distributing the incoming request two computing resources such as application server. So it will make sure that all of these resources are equally busy. So it will try to do a fair job. Again, it all depends on the algorithms. If you use a sticky session, so it might, the same request from the same client will go to the same worker as well. But again, it all depends on the server. We will cover that in later in our course. But it's important to understand that there's something called load balancer, which intercepts your request or and forward the request to the worker. So it acts as a proxy between that. I think the last part that we need to understand is how does Google or something like Netflix or Facebook, how are they able to serve requests so far? So they don't have, so most of these application use something called a CDN, which is called the Content Delivery Network. It is a globally distributed network of proxy servers serving content from locations closer to the user. So when you make a request, it will typically find out that your location is probably India. So if there is any data center near to India, probably in India or another in any other place in Asia, so it will try to serve the content from there. Typically, we use a content delivery network from static. We use content delivery network for static files like HTML, CSS, JavaScript, or photos, or videos, or images. But these days we also have CDNs which also cache content of your REST APIs as well. I think both Akamai as well as Netlify and others also do that. So there are multiple solutions in the CDN space as well. So this covers the broader question. We have not covered it in too much detail, but I think that will still give you a lot of information about the different components that are involved to serve a request. I think it's a highly complicated system, and it's amazing that it works the way it works so reliably. So I think now that you have a bigger picture in mind, now that you know how all of these things are, it will help you understand how to reason about these things, I think, in a better way. I also want to get few of other terms clear. I know probably you might already know that, but given this course is for people who are in the range of 1 to 2 years of experience, sometimes they have not worked in the web space. They were probably working on a desktop application or working on a very specific part, so they don't know what a web application is. So I will start from that as well. So web application is any application which is a client server, which follows the client server paradigm, and usually the client is the web browser. So that is typically what a web application is. Client is the user facing entity, so normally something that is running in your browser or in your mobile device as well. Server is what is responsible for doing the dirty job, doing all the background job, doing all the hard work is what the server is for. It provides the function or the functionality that you need to do. These days we are also moving into thick client-based application with single page application. You can do a lot on your client side as well, but typically web application you have clients are thin and servers are bit more heavyweight. Again, what we're talking about here is the web application are typically request response. You make a request, you get the response, and that's how you move on. You normally have an API that you talk to. A server receives requests from many distinct clients in a short period of time. A computer can only perform a limited number of tasks and relies on scheduling system to prioritize incoming requests. So that's what happens in the server. So server normally have a thread pool based on which it decides how many requests it can process at a single time. It can queue few things for you so that your server is not overloaded by the request. You can read that. Typically we had three types of applications: one tier application, two tier application, three tier application. So web application typically are three tier applications. This is what we normally care about. So one tier were the initially mainframe applications. So these are not web applications. I think probably different types of applications. I will let me just do that right now in different. Okay. So these are the mainframe applications. So you directly connect into their mainframe system and working on your machine. A 2-tier system for like something like a applet based application. So again, you have a thick client working and then they are talking directly to the server database, the server system. Something like Oracle Forms and all those ecosystem, 2-tier applications. Then we have 3-tier applications, which are what we normally use. So you have a client, which is a presentation layer, like a web application. Then you have a middle tier, which is the application server tier. Then you have a database. Typically, these days we only build 3-tier applications, and that's what we should be. That's what we will be focusing in this course. So you have client tier, which is the client computer where your front end is being rendered. Then you have an application tier where you have your application logic, and then you have a database tier which stores your data. Again, I already talked about it, presentation, application, storage. This course is not about user interface or presentation tier. We might go very basic of it, but I more or less it will be only focused on the backend development. So that's what we will be focusing on. A typical application front end is something that you build with HTML5, JavaScript, CSS. You normally will be using any JavaScript framework like React, Angular, or Vue as well. An application tier is typically provided by something like Spring Framework or Node.js, Ruby on Rails, in Scala or Java Play Framework, PHP Symfony. So there are a lot of options in both of them. And then databases, typically we used to only use relational databases like Oracle, MySQL or PostgreSQL, but these days we also have NoSQL databases like Mongo, Cassandra, Edgebase as well. And applications typically have more than one databases as well, so you can have a single application which uses relational as well as the non-relational databases as well. One more term that you should be aware of is the software architecture. So one way to look at software architecture is the best definition is, or probably the most abstract definition of software architecture is that important decisions that you need to take, whatever those decisions are. The whole point is that an architecture should help you reason about your system. So architecture, in my opinion, comprise of technology stack, which programming language you will use, which framework you will use, like Spring Boot if you're using Spring Framework, that's also part of it, which database you will have, whether you were deploying to cloud as well or not. Probably CI/CD, some part of that is also part of your software architecture. Then you also look about the non-functional requirement as well, like how much throughput your application need to support, number of requests per second, how many transactions it need to support, how much availability your system need to guarantee, how your system will scale out, what's the latency of your application. There are a lot of non-functional requirement, how you will secure your application, if you're do you have to be GDPR compliant, how will you do that, how security will be taken care in your application. And I think last thing that a software architecture needs to consider is the testability of the application. And when I say testability, I'm mainly talking about the automated testing of the application. I think an architecture can help enable that for you as well. On the right, you will see a simple web application architecture. So this is a standard reference architecture of a web application running on AWS. So you can see that it is using few AWS services like Route 53 for DNS, CloudFront for CDN, S3 for storage of the data. Then we have web servers, then we have application server. They are all auto scaled using the load balancers. And then we have database server. So a lot of solutions are there. This is basically a typical way, graphical way to represent your architecture, but then you have to add more details to the architecture diagram as well as few documents as well that help any other one understand the architecture of your application. A technology set is the set of technologies that you will use in your application. It's low level, or probably it only talks about the technology set. So architecture is a big broader term which encompass technology stack, but technology stack is narrow focused as compared to that. You normally talk about the languages, framework, tools, cloud ecosystem tools, build tools, continuous integration tool, databases that you will have in your system. And also I think one important thing that everybody needs to keep in mind is that you should not be going for the same technology stack in all the application. Different applications have different needs, and your technology decision should be based on that. So if you're a Java developer, you should not always be thinking about using Spring Boot based applications. You should probably try to understand what the application need is. You should also think about which database you need to have. Different databases are suitable for different needs. Like if you have a very highly available write system, then probably something like Cassandra is more suitable. A transaction store, you still might want to go with the relational database. So you still have to think about the problem domain and come up with the right technical architecture. And different technologies scale in a different way. They have different performance characteristics. So these things need to be considered. Now I think we have covered a lot of details about different aspects of web development. The last thing that I want to talk about is what I mean by a full stack developer. Because I've said multiple times to multiple people that I don't believe in a full stack developer concept. I think it's difficult to find one person who is good or expert in all of these. I haven't met yet any of the developer who is good in them. They all have their preferences. What to me full stack developer mean is that you can roll off your sleeves and try different technologies. So if primarily I'm a backend guy, that's what I enjoy doing. But in case I have to do the front end stuff, I will be open to do that. For some time I will try that out. You don't fear technology. This is important because a lot of time I feel that people run away from technology, which means that sometimes there's a need for, probably let's assume there's a requirement for a Python developer, a good requirement for Python developer, but you are a Java developer and you just don't even give it a try because you think that is not the space. I think you should be flexible enough to try different things. That is what I'm saying. If you're not worked on the cloud technologies and a work comes which is about cloud technologies, you should be still be open to do that. You should be ready to push yourself and do stuff that you haven't done before. And I think one more thing that I think about full stack is that you should be well versed with the ecosystem. You don't have to be expert on all the things, but you should be aware how different things fit. And if required, you should be able to take the informed decision. And you believe in automation in terms of the testing as well as how you can take your application from your machine to the cloud. Something like if you're a backend engineer, I think you should be knowing about Docker. You should be knowing basic about configuration management tool like Ansible. You should be knowing something about cloud tools as well. So that's what I will be focusing in this course, because that's what I consider important. That what concludes the first part of the lecture. I just want to give a small brief introduction to Git in case people are not aware of it. What you need to do is make sure that you have a GitHub account. I think you might not be part of the ZBA organization if you are an outsider, so that's fine. I also recommend people to use the SSH based mechanism to talk to GitHub rather than using the username password. So upload your public SSH key to your GitHub account and ensure that your GitHub username is linked. Try to ensure that both of these properties are set, so your users, your name and their email are set. That's how Git can configure who the username, who the user is. So you will see that information in your commits cleanly. If you want to verify whether information exists, just see the git config minus l. This is the homework repository that you have, so just clone it on your machine. Just go to git, open a terminal and type git clone git @ this repository, and create a new repository under your username, remove the remote origin, add a new remote to the repository, push changes, and add me as the collaborator. So this is mainly for the people who are going through the course in our office. So if you are listening out, if you're an external person listening to this, I think this is not relevant to you. Last thing that I will tell you is that follow this tutorial. So this is one of the tutorials that I wrote, I think, a few years back. This talks about basic of Git. In case you're not aware of it, I will recommend just walk through this tutorial. This will help you understand what version control system is, why you need one, what the heck Git is, how you can initiate a Git repository, what all is contained in a Git repository, how you can run the different commands that you need to know. I think that will help you get started. That's it for this lecture. So that's it for today. I will recommend you follow the Git missing tutorial. That will help you out. So what we learned today is we learned about web, we learned about internet, we learned about how they are closely related to each other. We talked about different tiers of web application. We normally will be focusing on the three-tier application. We talked about different terms that you should be aware of in when building web application, and I also helped you bootstrap on Git. Again, I have not taught much on it, but just go to the Git missing tutorial and you will be able to follow that easily. So that's it. So reading resources are available on this link as well. Thanks a lot for your time.